No.
Good. Oh, wow.
Whoa, you are really
Can
loud.
I get turned
You're
down?
Really loud.
I'm too loud.
True.
That's crazy. Good morning, everyone. So happy to see you this morning. Thank you for already standing and taking part of my job away. Let's worship.
Sing to the King who is coming to reign. Glory to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain. Life and salvation His empire shall bring. And joy to the nations when Jesus is King. Come, let us sing a song declaring we belong to Jesus. He's all we need. Lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus. Sing to the King. For His returning, we watch and we pray. We will be ready the dawn of that day. Cause Satan is fleeing with all the redeemed. Cause Satan is vanquished and Jesus is King. Come, let us sing a song declaring we belong to Jesus. He's all we need. Lift up a heart of praise. Sing now with voices raised to Jesus. Sing to the King. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Cause all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, and I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I'll give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, now forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. See, on a hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free. Look at the wounds that gave me life. Grace flowing from his side, no greater sacrifice. But what he's done, what he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, my future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. Sing for the freedom he has won. Even death is dead and done. His life has overcome. Speak, say the name above all names, over every broken place. He is risen from the grave. For what he's done, what he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, my future is heaven. Oh, I praise God for what he has done. Now, on a throne of majesty, the Father's will complete. He reigns in victory. Sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. For what he's done, what he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, my future is heaven. Oh, I praise God for what he's done. Oh, I praise God for what he's done.
You can be seated.
Good morning. My name is Scott Prisky. I'm one of the elders here at the church. And this is the time of our service where we celebrate the Lord's Supper. If you're visiting with us this morning, we do communion with these little communion kits. They were on the table as you came in this morning. If you want to participate in communion with us and you didn't grab one, just raise your hand and somebody back there will make sure you get one. As I said last week, for communion meditations this month, I'm going to talk about Matthew 6, 9 through 13, which is commonly referred to as the Lord's Prayer. I should say 2 weeks ago I said that. 2 weeks ago I covered what is commonly known as the address, which is Our Father in Heaven. Today I'm going to talk about the first three petitions or requests. But before we do that, I'd like us together to slowly recite the Lord's Prayer. So with me, Our Father in Heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. The first three petitions are requests. Next slide. Hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. 2 weeks ago, I shared the quote from one commentator who said, prayer should never devolve into the thoughtless ritual, into a thoughtless ritual to complete. In the Christian denomination I grew up in, we repeated the Lord's Prayer a lot. And as I remember it, I didn't really think much about what I was praying Only the need. I only knew that I needed to do it. As I got a little older and I started to study more what the words were and what they were saying, I was surprised to realize the phrase, "Hallowed be your name," wasn't just a meaningless part of the address. Kind of like we say, "Hi, how you doing?" We really don't care how you're doing. But the first petition, "Hallowed be your name," like every other phrase in the Lord's Prayer, when prayed with understanding and thoughtfulness, has a tremendous amount of meaning. The verb translated here as "hallowed" means to sanctify or set apart or treat as holy. It's important to recognize this portion of the prayer is not requesting that God or God's name will become holy. By its very definition, God and his name have always been and always will be holy. It is a request that God and his name be recognized and treated as holy. Former Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams, explained this phrase by saying that people may look upon God's name as holy, as something that inspires awe and reverence, and that they may not trivialize it by making God a tool for their purpose. Richard Schallner, I'm not saying that right, an 18th century Catholic bishop wrote that this petition holds the primary place in the Lord's Prayer because the first and principal duty of a Christian is to love God with all his heart and soul, and therefore the first and principal thing he should desire is to pray for God's name to be honored and glorified. Another commentator wrote, "We hallow his name by giving thanks at every remembrance of his goodness, by our utter humility, and most of all, by our submission to his will." The second petition or request, I admit, is one I struggle with. "Your kingdom come." One commentator says that this request, we are praying for the extension of or growth of Jesus' ministry here on earth and the consummation of creation. Now, I'm all for the growth and the expansion of the Christian church around the world, but the consummation of creation and the second coming of Jesus, I'm conflicted about. On one hand, as I said 2 weeks ago, I long for the day when I will be completely at peace, completely safe and secure, fully satisfied, without fear or care in the world, resting in the Heavenly Father's embrace. But at the same time, my heart breaks for the thought of Jesus returning before people I love repent and come to accept him as their Lord and Savior. So as I pray this part of the prayer, I pray for their salvation. And I pray God will help me to trust him more in this situation. The third petition or request is, "Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." John Ortberg interprets this phrase as follows. "Many people think our job is to get our afterlife destination taken care of, then tread water until we get ejected and God comes back and torches this place. But God never told anyone, neither his disciples nor us, to pray, 'Get me out of here so I can come up there.' His prayer was, 'Make up there, come down here. Make things down here run the way they run up there.'" The request, "Thy will be done," is God's invitation to join him in making things down here the way they are up there. Timothy Keller said that to pray, "Your will be done," is really asking God to heal or correct our perspective, to acknowledge that we don't know what's best, and God does, to remember that we are human, and God is God. I believe that as we each pray the Lord's Prayer, we need to reflect upon our own lives. Do our thoughts, desires, and actions hallow God and his name? Are we truly striving to be thankful, humble, and fully submitted to God's will? Do we sincerely desire that God's will be done more than we desire our own will to be done? If not, are we praying that God would change our hearts and give us the faith and strength to trust him? Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for who you are and all you've done. Thank you for putting on skin, coming to this earth, and allowing yourself to be tortured to death on a cross to pay the price for our sins. Help us to remember each and every day how much you love us and draw us into a deeper relationship with you. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to see all of you this morning. I do have some updates on some prayer items that I think are all in the bulletin. One, it's good to have Tom Giles here today. Tom's here, moving around. Hip replacement went well. And so just keep praying for Tom and his recovery. We'll get him running here sooner or later. Just pray for his continued healing for his hip replacement. Also, Ginger Waddell, that would be Vince Visker's girlfriend, fiance. I don't know the relationship quite there, but they are here a lot together. And so he asked that we would pray for her. She had a shoulder replacement, and she still has some pain, but she's doing better. So if you continue praying for her, I know she would appreciate that. And then Ed Oliver, a couple of you have asked about Ed. He had a blood clot in his lung, was having some issues. He's going for some tests this morning. They think, according to Ed, that they have got the blood clot taken care of, but they want to make sure before they let him go from the hospital. If all the tests come back well, he should be going home today. So continue praying for the three of them. I know they would appreciate that very much. Let's pray, and then we'll look at our text. God, we thank you for this time that we can be here in your presence, and glad that you are with us and that you love us and care for us. God, we thank you that you give us your word so that we can just spend time thinking about what you have done for us, how you work in our lives, how you change us. God, your will be done is a hard prayer to pray sometimes because we think that you're going to do so much in our lives that we won't look the same. And the truth is, that's what you're going to do. You're going to change us to look like you. And so, Lord, we ask that as we spend time in your word today that you would use it to shape us and mold us to look more like you, Jesus. That you would just speak truth to us through the text, that your spirit would reveal things to our hearts, that you would guide us and direct us, not only in this time as we look in your word, but as we leave this place and go throughout our lives and just see other people, that your word would be speaking to us all the time. God, I ask especially that your spirit would just speak through me as well, and just reveal things to me as well, things that I need to learn in this text. In Jesus' name, amen. This past Wednesday, we started our discipleship groups on Wednesday night. There's room for everyone to come and be a part of that. Tracy has a nursery. I have the grade school age kids. Jim has an adult group talking about following Jesus, about being a disciple. Jill's teaching a study in James, so if you have questions about that, talk to one of us afterwards. But like I said, I have the grade school age kids, and I got a curriculum that I wanted to use because I just wanted to be very focused on what I do with them. And the curriculum that I have deals with the life of Jesus. And so we'll study that for the next 3 months or so. That's how many lessons that I have. And it started off with the announcement of the birth of John the Baptizer to his father Zechariah in the temple. And so we're reading that text and going through that. And as we go through it, we get to the point where it talks about that Zechariah was very old and his wife was well along in years. And in an audience like this, that's probably easy for me to explain how that works. With 6 through 10-year-olds, that can be a minefield. Can I just say that? And so one free thing, guys, notice that Zechariah said, "I am old and my wife is well along in years." Do note that. We can learn from Zechariah. But, you know, I'm trying to explain to them how Zechariah and Elizabeth couldn't have kids, and so I'm trying to figure out what to do because, you know, you can't really talk about menopause or, you know, if someone had, you know, infertility or things like that. That's not really a conversation you want to have with 6 through 10-year-olds because then you get phone calls later from parents. So I'm like, how can I do this? I was like, okay, who has a grandparent that's, tell me about your grandparents. And I forget who was right next to me. Maybe it was Leah. And she goes, "Well, my grandpa's really old. He's like 81. I was like, perfect. I said, "Do you think he would have kids?" And then the others start chiming in. "Yeah, my grandpa's not going to have kids, or my grandparents aren't. They're very old too. And then someone, Case Harnett, goes, "Well, you know, a grandma could probably still have kids if they had someone at 20 and then their child was 20 and have a child. They wouldn't be that old. They could still have kids." And I'm like, well, I'm thinking that's not what the text says, Case, so just work with me on that. And so my solution was just kind of get them to understand that there are things that are impossible, because that was our memory verse, Luke 1:37, for nothing is impossible with God. And so just trying to get them to understand that some things are not impossible, even though that looked very impossible. Could you imagine that happening? God can do it. That was the story that we have. Well, our text today deals with something else that at first glance, or when the conversation was happening, the person talking with Jesus said, "This is impossible." And so we're going to be in John chapter 3. We're going to be looking at the story of the conversation that Jesus has with Nicodemus. We're going to see in the text how Jesus is the way and the truth and the life. All three of those things are present in this text. And so what we're going to do is read through the text and see, because Nicodemus, he's probably older, he's having a hard time understanding how he could be, or anyone could be, reborn. So John 3, starting in verse 1, we're going to go to verse 21. It says, "Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him.' Jesus replied, 'Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again.' 'How can someone be born when they are old?' Nicodemus asked. 'Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born.' Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen. But still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light, and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. So Nicodemus, having a hard time understanding how someone can be born again when they are old, verse 9, he asks, how can this be? So what does it mean to be born again? What does that look like? What is the truth Jesus is teaching us in this text? The truth in this text, I believe, is vital for us to know and be able to tell others about who Jesus is, about him being the way to God the Father. And so the rebirth that Jesus is talking about is not a physical rebirth. I think Jesus makes that clear where he says, flesh gives birth to flesh. He's not talking about that. Though I believe there is a physical activity connected to this, of being reborn. So I want to look at three aspects of being reborn that I think we can see in this text. The first one is this, that we are going to have spiritual rebirth. Again, Jesus makes it clear, not a physical birth. Verse 6, flesh gives birth to flesh, spirit gives birth to spirit. The word for spirit is pneuma. It's used both times, spirit, spirit. So, but if you notice, if you look in your text, in your Bible, the first one, I believe, is capitalized. So when you see that capitalized, it's referring to the Holy Spirit, because this word pneuma can have has multiple meanings, applies to different things. So the first S, capitalized, Holy Spirit, gives birth to spirit, small letter S. That is our soul or who we are. That is what God wants to redeem and save and purify and make his own. And so God the Holy Spirit is going to facilitate the rebirth of the human spirit of those who choose to be reborn. We are alive, but we still need to be reborn. And this text, sometimes people read this text and they think it just talks about being baptized. That this tells me I need to be baptized, and that's what the focus of the text is. Baptism is a part of this. The physical act of being buried under the water, raised to new life, yes, it's a part of this. But that's symbolic of what Jesus is talking about here. So I want to put a definition up on the screen. Some of you have seen me talk about this definition before, and here it is. God the Holy Spirit takes the initiative through various means in cooperation with our response. He changes us to look like Jesus in order to serve others to the glory of God the Father. J.K. Jones is a professor I had. He wrote that, came up with that. I think that describes what goes on in this text. Let me break it down for you. God the Holy Spirit takes the initiative. The Holy Spirit, when he comes into us, is not idle. before we accept Jesus, he's not idle. He's not like Jiminy Cricket hanging out on our shoulder talking to us. He's not like a spiritual couch potato that says, okay, I'm going to hang out in here and take a nap until they decide they want to be reborn and then wakes up and does things in us. He is active. He is pursuing us. He's taking the initiative to draw us to Jesus so that we can be reborn. There's activity in everything that he does. John 15 talks about this more. If you want to go and look there, I think it's verses 6, 7, 8, 9, talks about what the Holy Spirit does to bring people to the point they want to accept Jesus so that they can be transformed. So the Holy Spirit takes the initiative. He does this through various means. The Holy Spirit has lots of tools in his shed. There are many things that he is employing to change us. Certainly things like prayer, reading the Bible, listening to teaching and preaching, worshiping through singing and communion. We've done that. We are doing that today. Those are things that he uses to change us. Those are tools that he has. But those are a fraction, I believe, of the means that the Spirit uses to influence, to change people's lives. There's something called meditation. It's called focused thinking. Or we just read a text and we sit with it. We think about what that means to us, what God might want to do with that verse in our life. How does that change us? How do we live that out? He might do that through something called solitude. Solitude is just being off by yourself. I leave my phone over there every time that I preach. Do you know why? Because if I have it in my pocket, the game that I play would just be buzzing all the time and it would distract me. And so there's a need to be off in solitude to remove all the distractions that you have so that you can meditate, spend time with God, think about what he's done, what he's trying to do, to read the word. I do like to read the Bible on my phone and have it read to me because I like to not only see it but hear it. I feel like I like that more. But at the same time, I've got these crazy notifications that pop up. Sometimes we need to disconnect from everything so we can just spend time with him. Sometimes there's a need just to be quiet before God. That verse, I think it's Psalm 46:10, be still and know that I am God. Sometimes we just need to be quiet before. That may seem really weird or really hard to do, but do this sometime. Just sit for half an hour and just be quiet before God. The hardest part in doing that will be to not have your mind race from things you need to get done. But sometimes if we have a verse that we read ahead of that and think about that verse and just are quiet before God and try to not think about anything else going on, I think at times God will speak to us. May not be every time, it may only be one time, but I think he will speak to us. Sometimes when we have righteous indignation when we see evil, I think that's one of the means the Holy Spirit uses. Do you ever see something evil in the world and you just think someone ought to do something about that? Something different ought to be happening here. I think God can use that, the Holy Spirit can use that to draw us to Jesus. Caring for those who are hurting. I think that's one way God can use, the Holy Spirit uses to draw us to him. Serving people who are in need. Getting focused on other people, I think the Holy Spirit, I think at times prompts us to do that. And to focus on others rather than ourselves. Defending people affected by injustice. Again, maybe you see some wrong happen or you see someone who just needs protection or cared for. Defending that person, I think the Holy Spirit uses that. And I think he has many more things that he uses, many more tools, things to draw us in, that he takes the initiative, that he says, okay, I'm going to put these things out here. We have this empty space. We think something ought to be different here. Something ought to be happening here. Why isn't this right? Why is there evil? Why is there not good? And I think in that vacuum that he creates within us, he's going to suck us in, so to speak. He's going to draw us into Jesus and say, I know you're feeling this vacuum that something should be different. Let me show you different. Let me show you what it looks to follow Jesus. So then we come to the third part in that statement, in cooperation with our response. So if we're feeling all those things, we can respond a lot of different ways. Like if we see injustice or something happening or someone needing to be defended, we could go beat the other person up that's doing the wrong, couldn't we? But that doesn't really help the situation. What might need to happen in that situation is that we help the person who's being attacked. We care for the person being attacked. We respond to something that we see and we think, I need to be doing something different here. We have to respond to the Holy Spirit. That's the only way he can work in us. God is not going to compel us to follow him. We have to respond to what he's doing. We have to cooperate with him. It's like dancing. I don't like to dance because I'm really bad at it. And I think I would injure Jill if I did that, unless I do it very simply and very slowly. But other people can do amazing when they dance. The whole Dancing with the Stars, I don't watch that, but I can appreciate that. I can appreciate going to a ballet and see how all these different dancers can bring to life a story in concert together. We have to think of our relationship with the Holy Spirit as him taking the lead, and we are following, and we dance together, and it looks beautiful when we cooperate with him. So then the Holy Spirit starts to do things in us. Fourth part, he changes us to look like Jesus. He isn't changing us to be good people. Mark chapter 10, starting with verse 17, there's a story starting there about a man who comes up to Jesus and he says, hey, good teacher, what do I need to do to inherit eternal life? What do I need to do so that I'm okay? I just want to know how to get there. How do I get there? Jesus' response is really interesting. He says, why do you call me good? There's no one good but God alone. I think in that statement, he's trying to get people to understand, at least those listening and us, he's making a claim to be God in that text. They recognize him as good. He's saying, no one's good but God alone. You've inferred that. One more reason why you should believe in me. I think he makes that claim to be God. But then Jesus asks the questions. Have you kept all the commandments? No murder, no adultery, no stealing, no bearing false witness. You've not done any of those things. You're good on all that stuff. Follow the law. He's like, the guy replies, I've done all those since I was a boy. He's trying to say, I've done all the rules. I've done all the steps. I've followed everything well. I'm a good boy. Jesus looks at him and says, well then, go and sell everything you have. Give it all to the poor. Give it all away. The text says that the man went away sad because he had great wealth. God does not want to turn us into someone who's just good. I will never be good. I do a lot of good things, but I do a lot of things that are probably not good either. But I think with God working in me, he can help me become more like Jesus, to serve like him, care for others like him. See, a follower of Jesus sees everything other than following Jesus as absolutely worthless. In the grand scheme of things, it carries no value when you consider what only has eternal value. See, I don't think Jesus started carrying his cross the day he was crucified. I think he started carrying his cross from the day he was conceived. He just didn't have a physical cross that he was bearing. But he lived a life that reflected what he was going to do. And so God wants to change us to look like Jesus. Are we willing to live a life that looks like Jesus, that is willing to do whatever it takes to glorify God and to let him be known to others, to serve others in his name. We aren't being shaped into good people. We are being transformed into cross bearers whose identity comes from being united with Jesus. That brings us to the fifth part, in order to serve others. Being spiritually reborn is something that definitely benefits us, but is not just for us. It's not just for me. We need it. We need to be born again. But everything that's born in this world is expected to grow and mature, isn't it? Could you imagine that the farmer goes out in the springtime, plants all the corn, and the corn all pops up like this immediately, looks really good, and never grows any taller than this? How worthless would all that seed be? How worthless would that field be? If nothing good comes from it, if there's nothing produced, if there's no crop that can be harvested, God expects us to grow and mature. And so as we follow Jesus and are transformed to be like him, we will do what he did. And so the various means that the Holy Spirit used before to attract us and connect us to Jesus now become how we serve others, and then he starts using us to be the various means to other people to attract them and draw them to Jesus. Do you see the connection there? It's kind of a cycle that we are working in. And so things like love and compassion and patience and peace and kindness and other characteristics that the Spirit develops in us are now the foundation for how we live, for our actions, as we look like Jesus and serve others. And so following Jesus starts our transformation. And that's where it begins, but it matures and develops to seek the transformation of others to be like Jesus and follow him. And so, again, God will continue to use the Holy Spirit to shape each of us, to use us to shape others, to reveal that he's taking the initiative to draw other people to him through our lives as we faithfully follow him. And then everything, last of all, is done to the glory of God the Father. Everything we do is for God the Father's glory, absolutely everything. I'll confess to you that sometimes I'm not very good at that. I'll do things that I think are right, but then I'll realize later, well, that was pretty dumb of me to do that because that sure didn't glorify God. I can be right, but still wrong. And I'm not even talking about sin. I'm just talking about something where I feel like I need to say something, be right, and take some glory for myself. Or we need to do everything for his glory, because not everything we do will bring glory to God. So we need to figure out why we didn't in that situation, change how we did that. Maybe we did something, but we didn't do it with a mindset to serve others. Maybe we did something, but we did it and we weren't compassionate in it. We have to fight against selfishness and become selfless. And we empty ourselves of everything we think is important and necessary and refill ourselves with what God says is essential, to the point that our priorities change. So in John 3, I think what Jesus is teaching us is not simply that we need to be baptized and saved and then we are good. He is teaching us that we need to be reborn into new life that then lives for God's glory and purpose. And let me be absolutely clear, everyone needs to be baptized. We keep water back here in the baptistry all the time in case someone wants to be baptized. We have it ready. Watch last Sunday's sermon if you have any questions about what I'm saying. But baptism is absolutely part of God's plan of transforming you to look like Jesus and saving you from your sins, but it's not the final step. It frustrates me when I have people come and talk to me and they're like, I want to be saved, I want to be baptized. And it's like they do that and then I don't ever see them again, because they haven't understood it's not the final step. It's just one of the very first steps that God has planned for us to become more like Jesus and be used by him. Spiritual rebirth is what Jesus wants for all of us. But that will also lead to two other ways that I think we can experience rebirth. We will also have eternal rebirth. About verse 12 in the chapter, the conversation kind of turns and starts focusing on eternity, about heavenly things. Jesus gives a reference to a story from Israel's history. Nicodemus, being a teacher, would have known it very well. It's from Numbers 21, verses 4 through 9. That's where you'll find it. This is the story. The Israelites were wandering through the desert. They were there for 40 years. And so during that 40-year period, they needed to eat. You're out in the desert. People have to live. And so one thing God would provide every day was stuff called manna. We don't know exactly what that is, but they could take it, bake with it, cook with it, boil it, use it in various ways, and it would be enough to, you know, provide nutrition for them so they could get through the day. I had an elder in Ohio that thought manna was Twinkies, and I don't think he's right about that. There's not much nutritional value in Twinkies, but you kind of look at a Twinkie and you kind of go, well, what is that? Because you're not really sure how it got there and there's too many chemicals in it to properly identify everything in it. But this manna was there all the time, just as God promised them. It was always there. Well, one time in the story, they come up to Moses and God and they start complaining. We don't like manna. We don't have enough water. Why did you just bring us out here to die in the desert? Why couldn't we essentially just stay in Egypt? We like slavery better. Why did you do this? You're trying to kill us all. It's not always a good thing to tell God what he's trying to do, because sometimes he says, okay, if you think that's what I'm trying to do, sure, you can have that. So he sends snakes into the camp and they start biting people and people die. And then the people come back to Moses and say, look, we were wrong. We made a mistake. We have sinned. We need forgiveness. Will you pray for us? Moses says, okay. He goes and talks to God, and God said, oh, all right, so here's what we're going to do. You make a bronze serpent, and you put it on a pole, and you set that up, and if anyone gets bit by a snake, they can look at that pole, and they'll be okay. They'll be good. I'm glad I'm not Moses, because if I tried to draw things like Danica Korn, if you ever want to see some of the things she draws, and colors in her book, is just phenomenal. Me, I'm doing good to make like a stick figure person look good. And so if I was the one who had to make a snake, it'd probably look like a bronze hot dog that was like really long, kind of wrapped around a pole. But somehow Moses fabricates a snake and puts it on the pole, and everyone who looks at it is okay. Well, there's three things that I was thinking about that story. Like, why would God do that? First, was there anything special about that bronze snake? I don't think so. It was a bunch of metal just fashioned into a snake, put on a pole, and if people looked at it, they were good. It wasn't about the snake that saved them. It's whether or not the people had the faith to believe that if they looked at the snake, God would save them. Second, God used a snake. Could you imagine maybe what some of them were thinking? Maybe they went back to what we have, Genesis 3. Maybe they're thinking Garden of Eden. The word is the same in the Old Testament. For a snake here, put a snake on a pole, and the serpent who came to tempt Adam and Eve. Same thing. God, why would you use a snake to save us? We can see you using a snake to come into the camp and attack us, but why a snake to save us? And why would Jesus reference this? Maybe because it doesn't matter what Satan uses things for. He used the body of a snake to accomplish his purpose with Adam and Eve. But it doesn't matter what Satan has planned or what he does in people's lives, or even if they fail, God can redeem absolutely everything and use it for his good and his glory. I think that's why a snake, to show that there are no lives, no people we know that are not able to be redeemed by him, not able to be saved by him. There's no one in that category. But again, people have to cooperate with the Holy Spirit. They have to accept that grace and mercy. that if they do, God's holy power working in it can change everyone, can change anyone. Third, if God can use a snake to save, how much more powerful is it that he himself came to die on a cross to save? How much more effective is the gift of salvation in that act? Jesus didn't come to condemn. People don't always quote John 3:17 as one of my favorite verses. He did not come to condemn. He came to save. But if we don't believe in him, if we're not going to accept that, he's rather clear. We stand condemned already. Everyone's condemned. Not everyone chooses to be rescued. And if we accept the grace that he offers us, if we believe that he is who he says he is, we can be rescued from what's coming. Faith makes all the difference. And that leads to the last thing in the text, and that is there is a righteous rebirth, I believe, as well. Verses 19 through 21 talk about this. Jesus has come into the world. He is the light, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. They hang out in the shadows. They don't want anyone to see what's going on. But verse 21 says, whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, and God sees what they do. It infers that they live a life that reflects Jesus. And as God sees it, they are pleasing to God. And again, back to Jesus' baptism last week. Jesus didn't need to be baptized. He's not saved from anything. But God says, this is my son in whom I am well pleased. Us living our lives in the light, following the truth of God's word, living as he wants us to live, being shaped to be like him. It's not in our nature to live by the truth. It's not in our nature to want to be in the light. I had a friend of mine at Bible college said it's hard to follow God at times because sin looks like so much fun at different times. Satan uses whatever he can that looks attractive to other people, to you, to me. He makes evil look that way because that's part of temptation. Hey, do this. You'll enjoy this more. I know God doesn't want you to do this, but trust me, this will be good. You'll like it. And maybe for a few fleeting moments, we like it. And then the guilt sets in. The why did I do that sets in. The I hate myself sets in. I can't believe I did this. Does God still love me? We start doubting. I think Satan feeds into all of that. But he does love us. God died for us knowing everything we would ever do. He loves us. He chooses to give us eternal life and salvation. See, righteous rebirth is choosing to live in the light. It's not simply accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior, but remaining in a place, living our lives in such a way that everyone we come in contact with sees the light of Jesus shining from us. To be light in dark places. There's a lot of places where we go in life. Maybe it's where you work. Maybe it's where you go and eat. There are lives that have been destroyed because they've given in to sin. People who are walking in darkness because they don't think they want to follow Jesus. They think that's weird. Or they don't think God exists. We need to live by the truth. We need to show others that we are convinced that Jesus is the way and that it's their way too. So that one day they can be changed. So that they can experience in the final resurrection real life. The best life. The life that God has planned. Choose to be reborn. And if you've been baptized? That's great. Remember, it's only the start. We got to grow and mature and become the people Jesus knows we can be. He will use us and accomplish his purposes if we just cooperate with him. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the fact that you love us. We thank you for the fact that you accept us, that you provide forgiveness for us. Even though you know everything that we've done, every thought that we've had that is just contrary to you, every choice we've made, God, you still love us, and you choose to use us. God, I just ask that if there's anyone here that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, I'd love to just talk with them today and have a conversation about how you love them and care for them and want them to know real life in you. God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy and what you did on the cross for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Today, as we come to our time of invitation, if you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior and you want to know more about him, talk to me. I'd love to have a conversation with you. For those of us who follow him, how is God the Holy Spirit shaping you to look like Jesus? What is he putting in front of you? What opportunities is he giving you to serve others, to glorify God in everything that you do? How are you becoming a means for someone else to be influenced by God so that they can know Jesus as Lord and Savior? I hope that you consider that. Think about that. Let's sing.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace, in the light of his glory and grace.
Would you be seated? We've got a couple of announcements that we're going to make. The first one is this, guys. Thursday night, we're going to be going to Bass Creek for men's night out. So if you want to go to that, since it's only a few miles away, just meet there. I think it's 6:30 Thursday night. They've been doing some remodeling, and it looks like they're going to be reopened by Thursday. If for any reason they are not, then kind of once all we get there, we'll figure out a different place to go somewhere close. But I think they should be open based on what I can see. So that's this Thursday night, 6:30. If you have questions about that, please let me know. And Tracy also has an announcement.
Am I on? Oh, what a great sermon. give me a microphone. I'll try not to talk. We're all so excited, right? Thinking about, sometimes you start thinking about heaven someday, right? We're all going to be there, right? So many people. But you ever think about, well, I don't want to be with those people now. But we need to. So that's why I'm up here. We've got a lot of opportunities that have started this past week and today. So to give glory to God, to be more like Jesus, part of being the church isn't just sitting here on Sunday, but being a part of a group. And so there are so many opportunities that I just want to point out there in your bulletin. But this morning, we started a Sunday morning Sunday school class at 8:30. There's a good group of us. John is leading that. So if you're interested, 8:30 might be early for some of you. That's fine. We have stuff on Wednesday night. But if 8:30 works, it's in the fellowship hall. We're studying through Ephesians and then Colossians. And also on Sunday mornings at 10:30 after church, we have a senior study that happens on the stage. That's been going on for quite a while, but if you're not involved in that and want to be, they would welcome you there. And then Wednesday nights at 6 o'clock, we have three groups, like John said earlier. We've got one for kindergarten through fifth grade that John is leading in the fellowship hall. And then you can be a part of a group if you're a parent and drop your kids off. Or if you're not a parent, you can come. There's two groups. Jill is meeting with a group on the stage, guys and girls, so doesn't matter. And then there's another group meeting with Jim Jensen in the back here, and they are studying through the life of Christ, discipleship. And then if you've got little bitties, I'm in the nursery and I have help back there, so feel free to join in on that. And then youth group, Sunday nights, right, at 6 o'clock here, starts tonight. So that's sixth grade on up. So there are plenty of opportunities to be a part of a group, to learn and grow together, to learn what it means to be like Jesus, but also just to grow in your faith. We will never be done, so it doesn't matter how old you are. So, thanks.
Thanks, Tracy. Like I said, if you've got questions about any of those groups, please ask, and we can tell you a little bit more about them. So let's close in prayer. God, we thank you for your presence and your love and your faithfulness to us, and we thank you for how you work in our lives. Lord, for those of us who have been saved, we can look back and see how you've worked in our lives, how you've used other people, how you've used your word, and many other various means to shape us and change us and to make us look like you. Lord, now we are the means that you use, and so, Lord, use us effectively this coming week. Help us to just realize that everything that we do can bring glory to you and can lead others to know you as well. So, Lord, use our lives as examples. And, Lord, when the opportunity presents, please help us to be bold and speak truth and give people the reason why we have a hope that we have in you, that you are our Lord and Savior, and that you have prepared a place for us to be with you for all eternity, and that they can be there too. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a good day, everyone.